There is a process that occurs at the beginning of May every year, and it sort of rolls along with multiple steps as the months roll by. In May, the department heads get their worksheets to start working on the next fiscal year's budget. Of course, the city of Hayes budget is a calendar, so it runs from January to December. So in May of that year, we're working on the fiscal year subsequent. And then, of course, the department heads at the end of May, beginning of June, turn in their their department requested numbers. And then the administration takes it, the mayor and I, and we look at the budget for the next few weeks. And at the same time, at the beginning of July, we get our numbers in from the tax commissioner's office. The tax commissioner, of course, gets it from the tax assessors. And when the tax commissioner gives us the figures, we plug those in based upon recommended millage rate to our budget, have our budget workshop one, have our required public hearings, and vote on the millage at the August council meeting. That didn't happen this year. We did not receive numbers from the tax commissioner's office because the tax commissioner didn't receive them from the assessors. The understanding we received, we had a meeting amongst all the local governments, was that there were additional work that needed to be completed on the part of the tax assessors, and that delay was going to take somewhere in the neighborhood of 3 months to complete, and in fact, that was the case. So what we did is, in our fiscal year 16 budget, we took the exact same figure from our fiscal year 15 recommended ad valorem tax, and we plugged it in to fiscal year 16, because we felt reasonably certain that the digest would at least stay the same, would not have decreased. So using that figure, we had our budget workshop one in August, we had our preliminary budget approval in September, and then we didn't have a meeting in October, so the formal approval of the budget after advertising, which has occurred, will take place at the November meeting next Thursday, with a work session to follow next Monday, or to proceed. So that's sort of how the millage rate fits into the overall budget. But when we did receive our numbers in mid-October, we of course were under the gun at that point. The tax commissioner indicated to us that she wished to send out tax bills by November 20. And in order to send out tax bills, all of the millage rates from all of the local governments had to be set by October 30th. Well, because of state law, there were advertising requirements that had to be put in place. Those were lockstep, depending upon what local governments do. The recommendation of administration was to hold millage rate at 4.75, which necessitated three public hearings and advertisements. Those advertisements had to take place a week prior to when the public hearings were actually held. So around the middle of October, we had an advertisement that ran in the paper in the Austin Daily Times. And then we had our required first two public hearings, one of which was held at 11:30 last Thursday in the morning, and the other was held at 6:30 in the evening, both at City Hall. And we had some citizens attend, some of which are in attendance tonight, and some great discussion and questions that were had concerning that. We will have minutes of those meetings produced. They will not be available by next week's meetings, but we will have them for your approval and review in the month of November and approval in December, as well as the minutes for this special call meeting. So as the law goes, you have your two public hearings, and then the third public hearing is when you actually set your millage. And that, of course, is tonight. Some local governments are having them tomorrow night, but in light of everything else, we felt like tonight was the best time. Additional input for the third opportunity is sought from the public, and that is the purpose of this public hearing. So, to briefly talk about the advertisements that ran, we had a current 2015 tax digest and five-year history of the levy. In 2015, the digest is now approximately $69 million, about $69.5 million. The millage rate recommended for the city of Payara is 4.75. That was lowered from 5.38 back in 2012. And as far as we can tell, back to 1980 or so, and even maybe possibly longer than that, it's the lowest millage rate Payara has ever had. And is currently the lowest millage rate in the county, perhaps with the exception of Dasher, which from what I understand does not have a millage. So, $69 million digest with 4.75 mills is a receipt of around $329,000. Well, that is an increase. I'm getting the phone here in just a second. That is an increase of about $38,758, which translates to a percentage increase over the previous year. The way the state law reads is that is interpreted as a tax increase. And of course, that can be interpreted that way. That is the appreciation of the digest. It is not something that the city of Payara caused necessarily. The appraisers reappraised property within the city of Payara, and it came out that percentage higher. It came out at a higher appraised price. By holding the millage rate the same, with an increased appraised digest, that is translated as a tax increase. So, of course, I'm sure there'll be a lot of discussion about that. We can elaborate if we need to. And I've certainly talked a whole lot, but is there anything else that I missed before we have public input? Okay, and I can answer questions as well after all the public input's received, and we can continue forward with item number six.
Okay, I have one question. The tax digest allowance cap, is that been firmed up, or is that just still the guesstimate?
It's my understanding that the digest numbers were distributed at the same time to all the local governments. So Lowndes County's got theirs, the school boards have theirs, the cities have theirs. The only difference in that timetable that I mentioned a little previously is the Valdosta is not setting their millage until next week, next Thursday to be precise. And the reason behind that is that they cannot set their millage until the city school system sets theirs, so they're getting theirs in a little later. But the rest of us were asked to turn in our numbers by the 30th.
Changed their millage rate or voted on what it's going to be?
From what I understand, every local government within Lowndes County, and when I say local government, I'm talking about school boards and cities and cities, have chosen to maintain the same millage rate, which, because of the appreciation across the board, translates to tax increase. The only local government that chose to roll back the millage was Lowndes County, and that is taking place either today or tomorrow, and that was done by the Board of Commissioners.
So that includes the school board that's planning on leaving their millage rate the same?
That's my understanding.
Although that hasn't taken place yet.
I don't know when Lowndes County School Board is having their millage rates, but I'm understanding that all of them are taking place before the end of the day tomorrow. So.
The last thing I read in paper was the school board was what, eight bills? 8.3 bills?
An increase?
Wasn't the school board going up for increases? Anybody know the fact?
I don't want to speak out of turn, so
I'm not sure.
But it's my understanding that, with the exception of the county, everybody was holding the same millage, but that might be different. The only thing I will point out, too, at this point, is you can advertise for a millage rate increase and then decide not to, but you cannot advertise for a millage rate hold and then increase. So that is not on the table for the council tonight. You cannot raise the millage from 4.75. You can take one of two actions. You can either hold it at 4.75 or you can cut it. So that's there.
Okay. All right. We'll take public input. Anyone wishing to speak against millage increase or anyone wishing to speak against?
Can I I'm just trying to interrupt and be disruptive. Maryland died 205 Redbird Place, St. Ireland. I always have something to say. I was just going to ask, do you have a tax digest to distribute so that we can follow along?
It ran in the paper. But I can read the numbers.
Well, that's not the same. You know what? I need to look at it. I just wanted to clear up, to have a fair and balanced argument for, against, neutral, the information has to be correct. And I attended the first meeting at 11:30 last Thursday, and we were talking. I asked you the formula. Property value times whatever our millage rate is equals taxable.
And it's 40%.
I'm just talking about the formula. Where do we, you know, and what we use our ad valorem taxes to pay for in the city. And I look in the paper and see it reported, you know, there's the influence that, you know, someone would like to see infrastructure built up and all these various things, and that has nothing to do with ad valorem. You know, so it's kind of distracting for me. I don't know. Maybe I'm not giving people enough credit for understanding this whole process of millage rate, how the millage is set, what it pays for, that type of thing. So when I look at this, and I'm going, well, I'd like to see the infrastructure built up too, but that's not what my tax money is going towards. That's not what it's paid by, and that's pretty misleading. So, any education that you can give. The questions I ask, I think I have a fairly good understanding. Can't express it, but I have a fairly good understanding of how this works, the process. And then by looking at the budget along with it, I have a better understanding. But like I said before, you can't tell me that people understand what, you know, what pays for what, because before the first meeting started, one of the taxpayers said, well, I think we don't pay enough taxes. I'm like, wow. And then later on, it comes to find he thinks that we pay for infrastructure that way. So it's kind of, you know, names and times and dates later. But yeah, so it's kind of, you know, you can't tell me people are well-versed, and if it's up to me to find out, well, I need a little help. So, you know, that's why I'm asking you to have something to distribute, because looking at it, everybody didn't bring their copy of the newspaper, and that would be something, a tool that, you know, that would help right now.
If anybody wants copies of the digest that ran in the paper, I can email to anybody that needs one.
I'm saving it right now. I passed out my copy over there, but if I want to refer back to something that you're talking about, and I'm not, it's no slight on you. I'm just asking, did you have a copy prepared?
No, we don't have a copy. Well, what's your question, Mary?
My statement was what I just made. I just said it's misleading to think that we pay for infrastructure this way. What does our ad valorem taxes go towards paying?
Sure.
All right?
Let me answer. There's two parts of the question. Number one, you wanted to know how the actual tax formula, what the tax
I'm saying that I have to...
It's the assessed value, 40% of the assessed value times the 4.75, correct? So that's how you come up with the tax. Then, if I'm not mistaken, and I'm following you as a citizen, I'm getting educated as well. I just want to make sure I understand this as well. The dollars that are collected for property taxes go into the revenue budget, just like in our sales tax collections, and just like our fines and forfeitures. And they all go into the overall budget to pay for the operation of the services that we provide to the citizens. It's all, I don't think there's a dollar that's designated towards a specific thing, correct?
The general fund budget is encompassing of a lot of different components.
That's right.
Within expenditures.
That's right.
So when you talk about general government activities, which ad valorem makes up about 20%, that's property tax. Ad valorem is property tax. You're talking about public safety, which includes police and fire. You're talking about general government, which is the council and administration, and water sewer bill collection and the like. You're talking about streets, maintenance, and repair. So everybody that cleans up around town, as well as
public safety,
as well as any downtown activities that are done for special events, in addition to support activities for there are Meals on Wheels,
right.
AAA. I think that pretty much runs the gamut. So.
The easiest way to say it, Jonathan, is everything within the city, with the exception of the water and sewer.
Sure.
That's right. The easiest way to say it.
That's what it goes
to. The infrastructure of the water and sewer is a proprietary fund. Everything else beyond that is out of the general fund. So there's two funds set up. Proprietary fund, which has to be supported strictly by water and sewer. And that's part of the infrastructure. But everything else in the city comes out of the general fund.
But as they say, the dollars we collect from property taxes doesn't go towards water and sewer.
No, nothing. That I said water and sewer.
But that's not
infrastructure.
Water and sewer. Yes.
Water and sewer.
So infrastructure is not water and sewer. Infrastructure is.
No, that's infrastructure too.
Yeah. I mean, everything really is infrastructure of the city to run the city.
That statement that the taxpayer made was directed at. We have a 100-year-old sewer, water and sewer system. So that's what he was talking about, that particular system, which has nothing to do with ad valorem taxes. It's a little misleading. If I read that in the paper and didn't do my homework.
Can I ask who didn't say that?
Ted Baker.
Okay.
There was two of us at the meeting. That was the first meeting in the morning. And the first thing he said when we came in was, I don't think we pay enough tax. And this is why.
So that wasn't anybody up here, is it?
No.
Oh,
okay. No.
Okay.
Oh, I was misleading.
Okay.
No, the citizen, he wasn't.
Oh, yeah, tax.
Nobody in here told that.
That didn't get the Jonathan, you did a wonderful job. You answered the questions that were asked and gave a little. And so it was clear to me when I left. And it's still clear to me. But I'm saying the article that I read.
Okay, anyone else wishing to speak against?
He said, okay. Thank you.
My name is Rose Adams, 611 Hodges Street, and the very first thing I would say, Marilyn, is I have been taxed enough already. So I am up here to ask mayor and council to roll back the millage. We have senior citizens, we have people in Tejano on fixed income. Social Security, there will be no increase. When we go to the grocery store, we see the food, just the price of food, the increase, not to mention our medical insurance. All of these things are going up. And also, besides the property tax evaluation, Mayor, I believe that also includes new buildings, new businesses that have also changed the digest. Is that correct?
Yes, it's business.
So it is not just the residential. And also, Mayor, when you were campaigning for your position as mayor, you stated in the meet and greet that we had at the Tejano Historical Society building, very
loudly, you said, "I will not raise your taxes." So I'm asking you tonight just to stick with that. Thank you.
Anyone else wish to speak against?
My name's Tim Coons, AKA Gordon Road. Not necessarily speaking against, because I'm like Marilyn, I don't fully understand the process, but.
Excuse me, I understand it completely.
Well, I mean, the Envision Village rate, does that mean the Envision taxes are even the same?
Some people will see a tax increase if their assessments went up by the tax assessor's office. They see a tax increase if that has nothing to do with it.
That has nothing to do with our millage.
Some people will see a rebate. If their tax assessment went down, you know, they don't pay as much as they paid last year.
From that standpoint, you know, you gotta do your job. So. And as a business owner, naturally we don't ever want to see a tax go up.
Right.
And as a citizen, looking forward in the future, I feel like there's gonna be some really good things, really good businesses coming to AR soon. And have already. And if I was a potential business owner or somebody wanted to open a business, you know, you stated that we're lower than Dasher, lowest in Lyons County. Well, you know, that might be a good thing from the standpoint of a business owner wanting to come. Of course, they're also looking at all the city AR has to offer as well. But I would think that if we could draw some more businesses, of course, a member of the Merchants Association. You know, that's one of our duties, probably, or something we'd like to see is more businesses come to AR, fill up some empty lots, some empty buildings, some stuff over in industrial park. I don't know, as a business, are you looking for a lower, certainly looking for a lower tax. If that meant the difference between moving to Lake Park or Dasher or AR, that building rate meant the difference, then I'd like to see it. Kept low, but then on the other hand, you guys are, y'all the elected officials, y'all know the internal workings of it, so. Yeah, you guys should just display that now. Thank you.
Another thing to look at is how many homes have come online and are being taxed since the last year. And then you had at least a couple businesses that came in. So you're seeing the appreciation of those that have come on, as well as, like the gentleman said, whether the your property was reappraised, it may have went lower, or it may have went higher. So that's where you're seeing the appreciation at.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak against? Anyone wishing to speak for? Anyone wishing to speak in favor of? Okay, let's take comments from the council. Any comments?
Discussion. Okay, as I said in the second public hearing, I'm opposed to tax increases. And I contacted the tax commissioner's office, and she sent me a breakdown, and I do not have it with me. I have it at the house. I came directly from Gainesville here. Anyway, she broke it down for various houses, less than $25,000 up to $2 million. And the majority of the people going to be taxed or that have been hit with this tax assess value increase is about 50% of the homes in AR. And most of the businesses have been hit with the increase in the value. And just like Ms. Adams was stating, we have a number of senior citizens in the city. We have Medicare going up next year. We have medical expenses going out of sight. Health insurance going up next year for a lot of seniors, a lot of people. And I'd say there's probably 50% of the homes in AR are going to be affected by this tax increase. or close to it, that are in the upper levels. So I would urge this commission, or this body, to roll back the millage rate, at least this number around 50% or more of that $38,000. Now, I know the county, I was talking to Mr. Slaughter, who is the chairman, and they're, even though they're rolling back their millage, they're going to still benefit from the assessed values being raised within the county. So even though I think 1.4 or 1.6 mills are dropping it back, he's going to see a large net increase in revenue. The county. Well, this is what Bill told me yesterday.
You can't realize an increase in revenue if you roll back your millage.
If you roll the millage back more than the tax digest, yes, that's true. But if you don't roll it back as much as the tax digest, you will not see that.
Okay, I got you.
Am I correct? That statement.
If you roll back, the term rollback is if you're rolling it back to be revenue neutral to what you collected last year.
Yeah, they're not revenue.
If you're not rolling it back, if you're just cutting it a portion, then yeah, you can.
He said they're going to see a net increase in revenue, even though they're rolling back some amount of 1% or mills. But I would urge his body to reconsider holding the millage rate. I would like to see it drop back somewhat. I think that would be in good faith of the people of AR, to show that we do care, that we are understanding the needs of the citizens.
That's a service that's being provided that we want to continue to provide. And like you said, that's our millage is the lowest it's been in 35 years. Our millage is the lowest is the lowest it's been in 35 years.
I don't know what the digest beyond what Jonathan sent out. But don't forget, when you have 1,000 people living here in AR or less, than what you've got now. And if you look, and I hate to bring this up, but we're asking the people to sacrifice more, and I'm sure everybody understands Washington and what's happening up there. We're asking people to sacrifice more. And, we gave a COLA increase to employees at 3%. And it's coming up now to December, where we're going to discuss giving bonuses out to employees. And then we pay 100% health care. We're doing an awful lot internally.
I will comment that employee salaries and wages are still far below market average. I mean, I understand the perception that's there. But, as far as Christmas bonuses, that may mitigate a small portion, but as far as where wages are for the council, the staff, comparison to our market with other local governments, it is not a comparison.
And plus, we've been able to do that. We've been able to do that every year. It falls within the budget. Budget is approved. It's watched with everything else that's spent inside the city. And to bring that up as a reason for this,
I'm just saying that we're asking the people to sacrifice.
Our personnel is very important to us, and I don't know that there are too many folks who work like they do for the wages that they work for and the compensation they get. Yes, I think we're fair, but I don't think we need to be utilizing that as an example of why we shouldn't do what we're.
That was brought up to me by a couple of
constituents. That's a budget item. We think there's a value of the people who work in this city, and I value them, and I don't think that we should be using that as a means. I'd like to also add, this, and this is my view of this. This is the first time since I've been here that this has been approached, and so I've mulled over in my mind about the pros and cons of leaving it like it is. Number one, and I've worked in a public environment using public funds in higher education for years. I keep bringing that up, but it's very simple in that you have a process that requires for you to project revenues before they're collected. And then you have a process where you give projected expenditures before it's spent. And that's a process in the public that in accountability and credibility and in public government and in public business that you have to do. You have to be upfront and you got to say, we think we're going to collect, we project we're going to collect this amount of money to run the city on. And then you project what you're going to spend. And of course, we all do the best we can to project the spending. And I think that the city has shown that their projections have been hit pretty well over. I don't think we can show where there's been huge differences in what we've projected and what we've been able to do. In fact, I would say probably most years, maybe not as much. But revenues is always, you're expected as a public servant to meet those expenditures with a projected amount of money that you really have no control over, because somebody else is providing that resource to you. Somebody else, that's not us, that we're not going out to a tree and pulling it off a city-owned tree for money. It's coming to us from a source that's out of our control, really. We have to depend on someone coming to our town and buying goods so we get 7% sales tax. We have to depend on somebody in good faith coming in and paying that property tax to meet that budget. And so when you look across in the last couple of years and what was projected and what was collected over the last 4 years that I asked Jonathan to provide to me so that I could get a grip on this. This is the first time I'd seen the figures when I was running through my head. In 2010, we collected $10,410 more dollars. He gave me a projected amount that was projected at the beginning. And then at the end of the year, when it was audited, what we actually collected. And so at the end of 2010, we had a $10,410 overage. We collected $10,000 more. In 11, we collected $8,400 less dollars. In 2012, we collected $2,300 less dollars. In 2013, we actually collected $20,000 more dollars than what was projected. But this past year, and of course he's made a note that this is unaudited at the time, but it's an anticipated $39,000 less than what was projected from 2014. Okay? So if you add all of those up, over a five-year period of time, we collected right at $19,643 less than what we projected, that we collected. Now that's right at $20,000, divide that by five, that's about $4,000 a year. That our millage, and that millage is thrown out there as a calculation, but we think that millage is going to be something that will meet our projected spending. And we've hit it, according to this, after that over a period of time, comes to about $5,000 less a year that we collect. So, to me, the system has worked in how it should. I'm not one who thinks that if you raise it one year, you might have to lower it the next. If I'm going to budget for my personal income, I would rather over-anticipate revenues and under-anticipate my expenditures. Because I want to make sure at the end of the year I'm in the black. To hit it right on the head and say, you got to come up with a zero at the end of the year when it's projected, is not good personal budgeting that most financial planners will tell you it's not. And I have found that if I am trying to calculate my projected income on what I'm projecting I'm going to spend, and I want it to be zero-based at the end of the year, I don't think I would hit it too many times. Because there are always those unheard-of things. So from that standpoint, I'm inclined to say we're at a millage based on an assessment that, a projected assessment, that we don't know we're going to collect. It says $38,000, but we won't know that $38,000, based on these last 5 years, we don't know that it's going to end up $38,000 more, because it's a projected number. We could collect less. That's if we collect 100% correct. Okay? So, I take that into account. Tell me if you get home and then you just turn off the mic. I got to go to my next thought. And I understand the philosophy that the state says that you must call when your millage rate stays the same, but your assessments go up. I can understand why they call that a tax increase. I can. In reality, it would be that the person is paying more tax. But here's my question. We have a 7% sales tax. It's been 7% for how many years? 10 years?
A lot.
Okay, if I were to go down to Hardee's and buy myself $50 worth of groceries 5 years ago, and I paid 7% on that $50, my tax would be $35, am I right there? Okay. If I went to Hardee's 5 years later, and I